Nicholas is going to tell us something about the responses and compliments. Take it away.
Thank you. Hello, everyone. Actually, I'm going to start a little bit different than I originally planned. And inspired by our keynote speaker, I will be honest with you. I am a very inexperienced speaker, and as a very inexperienced speaker, I would like to encourage you and give you a strong round of applause.
Introduced by W3C to allow us as developers to create
our own needs in other tasks, which can be served with other people, and which encapsulate their own functionality. Everything started by a draft and a W3C called Introduction to Web Components. Now, when I sent my application for this talk, I actually had a couple of slides explaining Web Components, explaining what algorithms, what templates are, and custom elements, HTML imports, etc., etc. However, I realized later on that this is not necessary. Actually, we already had two talks about it, and we definitely are in a place to understand Web Components, and we don't need to go further. This allows me, though, this is some time, so it allows me to talk about what Web Components are in essence and why we are so excited with them, why everybody has used them actually, eagerly waits for larger adoption by browsers. So if there is one thing that we hate as developers, I think it's repetition of code. Nobody likes to write the same thing twice, and until now we've never had an easy way of avoiding repetition for our market. And now with Web Components, basically, we do have a way to create our own reusable units. Also, another high quality as a community is that we have is that we like sharing, and we share our knowledge, we share our experiences, and we share our code. And Web Components allows us to do that even better by allowing us to import HTML in our documents. And finally, the great thing about Web Components is that they play well with apps. With the power of encapsulation, we are always certain that our Web Component will never break another guy's page, and his page will not break our Web Component. As an experienced user, I got one advice: don't do any demo, don't do any live coding. I didn't follow it, so I just thought that everything goes wrong. Let's see now how that video Web Components. For the purpose of demonstration, I created a very simple Web Component. And it's a little code. It looks like this. It doesn't have any functionality behind it, and I won't go into the code of how it was created. This is a very simple login form, and it also is kind of responsive. So as soon as I change screen size, the login form responds accordingly. Now, let's take a hypothetical scenario, and let's assume that the people from WebCamp wanted to do the login form on the website that they didn't know how to do it, and they called me and they asked me, hey, can you put a login form on our website? And I would say, yeah, I have a thing for you, and the thing is a Web Component. So I would go to the website, I would open my favorite editor, it happens to be the network inspector tools, and then I would try to import it, just like Martin did in the previous. And I have a link here, take the link, I import it. And now we first get, and now let me try to add in the markup just after the header. I'll make my element login, just login actually, for the first chance. And suddenly I have it here in their page, which is quite cool, and they don't need to worry about anything. The other good stuff is, like we talked about, encapsulation. My styles are there. My styles are not affected by anything that they had on it. My styles, which are pretty crappy and pretty obtrusive, didn't break any of the page styles. Which is nice. On top of it, my responsiveness stays. So, when I start and resize the page, it does stay. And that's really cool. Now, what happens though, if they change their mind and they said, we don't like the login form there, like before, like after the title, but we want the login form to be on our sidebar. I would say, okay, let's try and put it on the sidebar. So I would go here. And I will try to add my login form just like before. And it broke. And it broke. And basically, what I just demonstrated is why responsive web design at the moment is slow. It doesn't allow us to do anything else than medical screening. And that's a big problem, because with web components, we can never make a safe assumption on where our web component will be used. The question is there anything we can do about it? There is the concept of element queries. And basically, element queries are exactly the same as media queries, but instead of checking the screen size, they are applying an element. And an element query has a syntax on CSS. It would look something like this. The concept is very simple and very easy to understand. We have a couple of images, but when we have an appropriate designer, the media query is basically welcome on the screen, like we have been saying. So on a screen with 1.2K, you have an article with floating image to the left. When the screen becomes 400 pixels, the article looks like that with the image on top. Now, an element query would never care about the screen size. It would only care about the place that the article is positioned. And based on that, it will just check that the article has only 1K of pixels available to it, so it would solve like this. And it would be the same on mobile, we wouldn't lose anything, because the area that the article has available to it is exactly the same. But it opens up a lot of opportunities, and we can place it on a sidebar on the same screen without caring about the size or any other device, actually. Now, what I said is not exactly something that we can use today, unfortunately. It's only a concept. There is no W3C specification for it yet. And the reason there is no specification for it is because there is a problem called circular dependency. I'll try to get a bit brief about it, but in this scenario that I demonstrate here, the wrapper has an element query that says when the width is less than 100 pixels, then make the width 200 pixels. And this breaks everything. So this problem has not been solved yet, and that's why W3C cannot go on and make element queries and specification. The truth is that people have been working on this thing, and there are a few polyglots. Actually, polyglots is a bit of an abused term because they are not exactly polyglots since there is no specification. But there are at least three projects at the moment that help us use element queries with a limited functionality today. Also, while doing my research, I saw that there is a collection by Dan Donald, and it's actually a pretty good collection with everything. I will search the station later on to look at the links and everything you can find there. So let's try another demo now. And this time, we'll go here. And basically, I have the same web component. The first one is exactly as before, whereas the second one has this concept of element where it's applied. And if we take it on screenery size, we'll see, we'll see that both of them react the same when the screen size changes, so that element queries essentially don't limit us in any way. However, if I don't change the width size, the screen size, but I only change the element size, and I start reducing it, we'll see that the one that has the element queries only starts working perfectly, whereas the other one breaks. So how would this change our login form on the webcam website? Let's try it. I'll use my name as HTML import the end. I go to the head. I edit. It has fetched the resource, and now I'll try to go to my sidebar, and I will try to add it here. It's the second element, so it's called the body responsive. And essentially now it works perfectly fine. And of course, it will keep working fine no matter how much we resize the page. So now the media queries on the media queries on the page actually kicked in, so everything changed. But this thing continues to work perfectly because it only needs to know its area size. So, some final thoughts before we close it. For me, this is the greatest value of web components. The web components are actually meant to be used by other people, and this is a great benefit of them. Sure, there will be projects where you will use custom elements just to provide the code, but my prediction is that web components will basically, with web components, will work exactly what happened with jQuery plugins. There was a time that everybody wrote jQuery plugins, and you could download the jQuery plugin about anything. The same would happen with web components. Actually, the same is happening. You saw what Martin did before, and there is not only custom elements.io, there is one by Google, I think it's called Brick, and another one called Component Kitchen, and a couple of more. The second very important thing is that media queries are no longer enough for us. There is an article, I'm sorry, I don't remember who wrote it, but basically it says that media queries are a hack, and that's true. Media queries do not help us do responsive web design exactly as we would like to do it. And finally, the future is unpredictable. You don't know what responsive web design will look in a year's time or in 2 years' time, and you don't know what people will think. We have talked about team and before, and he put a totally different perspective on web responsiveness. And I never thought about that because I was always thinking of it as a developer. So you can never predict. The only thing that's certain is that we are in an industry that moves really fast. And the truth is that for the past 5 years, responsive web design as a developer has changed much. So that kind of points to the fact that it will change soon. And we just need to anticipate it.
You said that when you put your component inside, you said it won't break any CSS of the page you do. Okay, but is it easy enough to overwrite CSS of the component from your page?
So, web components gives us encapsulation, but they also give us an API to do that. So there is a way, and there are specific CSS rules that can do that, yes, if you want.
One question, maybe this is a question for previous speakers, but doesn't matter. Is there a way to conditionally load the web component? What I mean, if you load the image and the background and the TV screen, you are not making a request to the server. Is there something like that for web component?
I'm sorry, can you repeat the question? Are you asking about when we are using HTML imports, how many requests happen to the server?
Well, generally speaking, is there a way to load component on desktop and not to load on mobile?
I guess the same as it would happen with any other type, right? How would you do that?
Like there is some JavaScript that is running for web components. You need to make conditions and write some JavaScript code that will be executed. Are we to stop the code from executing conditionally?
But essentially, web components is only HTML and JavaScript, just like anything else. So anything that you can do with normal HTML and JavaScript, you can do it with web components. If you want to do different things in mobile and in browser, yes, you can do it as you do it today. Depends on what you plan doing. So if you build an application of your own and you just need your components to tidy up the code, do not really write the same markup twice, and you don't need to really use it, I'm not sure really, I guess, not to use Sadler. As long as you don't use Sadler, they basically use the same scope, it's just real typing on the HTML. So then you don't need to take a special measure for what you wanted. The other thing is that as technology evolves, best practices will evolve with it as well, I believe. And there will be soon some best practices about how autonomous should our component be, and whether it's better if actually work of a custom element looks only on its own scope, or whether it should expose some kind of API to communicate with others. So I don't have a direct answer to that. It depends on what you want and what the future will be.
Hey, do you think that, for instance, web components will become a part of user interface pattern libraries and so
on? Yeah, how?
Will it be a part of user interface pattern libraries?
I hope so. That's what they are meant for, right? I mean, if you see like Martin is doing actual work, and he's doing that thing, he's building a UI that's composed of a lot of web components, right?
And reusable.
So yes, that's what people want it to be.
So is it possible for different web components to interact with each other? I'm carrying, for instance, if you have one web component that contains the filters, let's say date filters, and then you have one web component that shows the table and the other that shows the graph, is it possible to set the filters and then to exchange the graph based on the filters that you set?
The short answer is yes. So yes, you can do it. And one thing I want to clarify, I don't know if it's not very clear in our three talks, it's not a web component, right? It's a custom element. It's your own tag, your HTML tag that you can use. And web components is a set of all these things. So you can have a custom tag, like I said before, that doesn't use Sadler though. It doesn't use Sadler though. It's on the same scope as everything else. So it's very easy to interact using nothing else. But even with Sadler though, there is an API to go between the Sadler boundary and out, so you can have that if you want.
Thank you.
So we have one question.
Sorry, so it's not a question. Just to follow up on, if I may, follow up on your question. So you asked about whether web components can talk to each other, communicate to each other. So if you remember from Martin's presentation, he was using the Polymer library. So the way that Polymer library works is that they have created elements with which you can make Ajax calls. So then you just call that element inside the element that you're building, and then you just reuse the response like a JSON, and then you implement that inside your component, right? So you can create custom components, and then in your next custom component, you can just import that to the HTML import, right? So you can kind of chain them together. And then about the other question about the UI. So on the last Google I/O, there was a discussion on the paper elements. So they have this new design for the Android browsers and everything, the medical responses, etc. So again, they are making an effort to allow people to have a nice UX experience, and again, that is using Polymer. Sorry,
let's talk afterwards because I have another thing.